The Essentials of Indian Philosophy by M Hiriyanna, M.A. George Allen and Unwin Limited, Ruskin House, Museum Street, London. First published in 1949. Preface. It is now some years since my Outlines of Indian Philosophy was published, with the intention chiefly of providing a handy textbook for students in our universities. A simpler and shorter account of the subject is required for the general reader, and the present attempt is to meet that requirement. It is hoped that the book will be found suitable for the purpose, and that it will receive the same welcome as was generously accorded to its predecessor. The subject matter of the two books being identical, there is naturally a certain likeness between them, but it will be seen that no portion of the earlier volume has been verbally reproduced here. The present work, in accordance with the aim kept in view in writing it, leaves out many of the details included in the previous one. The difference between them, however, does not consist merely in these omissions. There is also variation in the treatment of some topics. As for instance, in the first two chapters dealing with early Indian thought, at least in two cases, again, there are important additions. In the earlier book, Buddhism was dealt with in reference to two stages of its growth. There is a third phase representing the doctrine as it was originally taught by Buddha, and a brief resume of it as it has been reconstructed by scholars in recent years also finds a place here. Similarly, the account of the Vedanta has been amplified by the inclusion of the Dvaita system of it. In reading of such a subject as Indian philosophy, it is difficult to avoid the use of Sanskrit terms, but their number appearing in the body of the work has been reduced as far as possible, and a glossary is provided to help the reader finding out their meanings readily. I have utilized in the preparation of this book two of my works contributed to the Aryan path and another to the Indian culture. I am grateful to the editors of these publications for their courtesy in permitting to do so. Specific references to the articles are given at the appropriate places in the notes appended at the end. I wish to record my feeling of indebtedness to the late Dr. J. E. Turner of the University of Liverpool for his kindness in reading the book in typescript and for his valuable suggestions. Finally, I desire to express my deep gratitude to Professor S. Radhakrishnan for the kindly interest which he has always taken in my work. It is no exaggeration to say that, but for his help and encouragement, neither this book nor the previous one would have been written. April 1948, M. Hiriyanna. Contents: Vedic Religion and Philosophy, Transition to the Systems, Non-Vedic Schools, Nyaya Vaisheshika, Sankhya Yoga, Purva Mimansa, Vedanta Absolutistic, Vedanta Theistic. Notes and References, Sanskrit Glossary and Index. Chapter 1. Vedic Religion and Philosophy. The earliest source of our information regarding Indian thought is the Veda, which signifies, as it has been stated, not a single work but a whole literature. This literature is usually regarded as consisting of two parts, namely mantras and brahmanas. Several of the early Upanishads are included in the latter, but on account of their great importance in the history of Indian thought, they deserve to be reckoned as a separate portion of the Veda. Broadly speaking, the three parts mark successive stages in the growth of Vedic literature and also stand for teachings that are more or less distinct. The determination of the exact chronological limits of these stages is not possible. Even the duration of the Vedic period as a whole is not definitely known, though the question has exercised the minds of scholars for long. All that is certain is that the Veda proper, including the chief Upanishads, is older than Buddha, who is known to have died about 480 BC. The later limit of the Vedic period may accordingly be taken as 500 BC. As regards the earlier limit, the belief that was generally current till recently, and that which has not yet been given up wholly was 1200 to 1500 BC. The view that is now replacing it is the one set forth by Dr. Winternis in his History of Indian Literature, which fixes the beginning of the period somewhere between 2000 and 2500 BC instead of 1200 to 1500 BC. It is not known what changes, if any, will be found necessary in this conclusion when the momentous discoveries made in recent years in the Indus Valley near Mohenjo-daro and Harappa are fully understood. These details, however, are not of very much importance for us here. We shall therefore proceed to consider the teaching of the Veda in its triple division. 1. The word mantra may be regarded as equivalent to a hymn or religious song. The hymns or religious songs contained in the Veda of varying age, the oldest of them being separated from the latest by several centuries. They were at a later stage, that is, long after the period of their production, brought together and have been preserved in the form of separate collections, Samhita. Two of them, to which we shall occasionally refer in this work, are called the Rig Veda and the Atharva Veda. We do not know what proportion of the sacred songs existing at the time were included in these collections, but we may safely assume that the whole of the material is not found in them. We have no right to suppose, says Max Muller, that we have even a hundredth part of the religious and popular poetry that existed during the Vedic age. We shall, in the present section, take into account only the earlier mantras, postponing the consideration of the later ones to the next section dealing with the Brahmanas, to which in their teaching they are more akin. We have, however, to remember that several of these earlier hymns are too obscure to admit of a satisfactory interpretation. This obscurity, together with the incompleteness of the hymn material we possess, makes it hard to reach anything like certainty regarding the character of the beliefs which prevailed in that age as a whole. We shall therefore content ourselves with citing here the view now commonly accepted by scholars that these early mantras inculcate a form of nature worship and that this religion of nature was in its essence transplanted from their original home when the ancestors of the future Aryans migrated into India. In this religion, the various powers of nature like fire, Agni, wind, Vayu and the sun, Surya, amidst which man lives and to those whose influence he is constantly subject, are personified. The personification implying a belief that the order which is observable in the world, such as the regular succession of seasons or of day and night, is due to the agency of these powers. They are accordingly looked upon as higher beings or gods, whom it is man's duty to obey and propitiate. Hence, the hymns may generally be described as chants or prayers addressed to deified powers of nature, regarded as responsible for the governance of the world. The gods thus worshipped are very many. Some of them, like Agni, the god of fire, who is represented as the carrier of gifts to the god, belong to the period anterior to the occupation of India by the Aryans, while others like Usas or Dawn, worshipped as a goddess and described as a blushing maiden pursued by her lover, the sun, are later creations by them in their new home. Although the Vedic pantheon is thus quite large, some deities, as they appear in the hymns that have been preserved, are more important than others. But we may note, by the way, that Shiva and Vishnu, the great gods of later Hinduism, although not unknown to the age, are not among the former. Of the relatively more imposing deities, it will suffice here to refer to two, namely Varuna and Indra. In the words of one of the mantras, they are the two monarchs that support all living beings. The distinguishing feature of the one is his unswerving adherence to high principles, that of the other his eagerness to protect his devotees by vanquishing their enemies in battle. The latter, namely Indra, is the leading deity of the hymn collections taken as a whole. He represents mainly valor and force, but he combines with those traits certain others which one would not like to associate with the idea of the divine. Thus, he is vain and boastful, and he is uncommonly fond of an intoxicating drink extracted from a creeper called Soma. But he seems to have come to hold so exalted a position among the Vedic gods through some accidental circumstance. That circumstance might have been as indicated by his description as the protector of the Aryan color and as the destroyer of the dark skin. In a necessity that arose for seeking the aid of a martial and self-assertive deity by the immigrant Aryans in subjugating the hostile tribes who were prior residents of the land which they had invaded. Or it might have been the havoc frequently played by femen in their new home, as shown by the description of Indra as a thunder god and as the liberator of the waters by slaying the demon of drought. Professor Radhakrishnan writes, when the Aryans entered India, they found that, as at present, their perspective was a mere gamble in rain. The rain god naturally became the national god of the Indo-Aryans. Two. We have so far spoken of the earlier hymns and shall now proceed to consider, within the limits set by our plan, the thought of the later hymns and the Brahmanas. The word which is derived from Brahman, meaning prayer or devotion, signifies an authoritative utterance of a priest relating particularly to sacrifice, and Brahmanas are so called because they are the repositories of such utterances. Speaking generally, the thought of the earlier hymns is seen in this period to develop on three lines: monotheism, monism, and ritualism. The first two of these, however, are often found mixed up with each other. But the conceptions themselves, as will be explained soon, are quite distinct, and this is the reason for our dealing with them separately. Monotheism. The belief in many gods of the early hymns now becomes more or less definite monotheism. The tendency to it appears already in those hymns in various ways. One of the most important of them is the likeness of the gods to one another as they are described here. There, they all share certain features which suggest that their identity was already recognized, though but half-consciously. Thus, all gods are luminous, as shown by the common epithet of Deva applied to them, which is derived from a root meaning to shine, and all, as noted before, maintain physical order and are friendly to the virtuous. This tendency now develops further, but it does not result in a fully rationalized conception of a supreme god as required for monotheism in the ordinary acceptation of the term. It aims rather at the discovery, not of one god who is above other gods, but of the common power that works behind them all, or, as we might otherwise put it, the principle immanent in all of them. What is but one? Wise people call by different names as Agni, Yama, and Matter is one. The conception of the supreme god in the later Vedic period may consequently be said to be more philosophic than religious. Omnipotence, for example, which is a characteristic of all the gods, becomes personified as the highest under the name of the all-doer, Vishwakarma. He is the great architect of the universe, says one hymn, who knows all, who assigns to the gods their names, and to whom all go for instruction. This attempt to derive a general and virtually impersonal conception of the supreme god from the common characteristics of deities is, with a remarkable freedom of speculation, made again and again, so that we have, in the period, a number of such conceptions which succeed and replace one another. The most prominent among the conceptions of the supreme god, so enthroned and dethroned afterwards, is that of Prajapati or Father God, whose name implies that all created beings are his children. This title is found used first in its literal sense of Lord of Creatures as an attribute of various gods, but later it ceases to represent merely an aspect of divinity and acquires an independent status. Thus, in an oft-recited hymn of the Rigveda, to a question repeated 9 times, who is the god to whom we are to offer sacrifice? The answer is given that it is Prajapati, who is the one lord of all created things. He is described elsewhere as born of Ritha, the principle of righteousness which rules the world. And the description shows that though the deity is abstract, being the result of elevating a mere epithet to the rank of the Almighty, it does not lack the moral exaltation characterizing the earlier and more concrete gods. Indeed, he is often regarded as an ethical authority. Prajapati represents the highest conception of unitary godhead in the later mantras and brahmanas taken as a whole, but even that is replaced in course of time by others, and still later, as for example in some of the Upanishads, the deity is reduced to a clearly secondary rank under the designation of Brahma. Monism. Another direction in which the thought of the earlier hymns develops is definitely philosophic, tracing the world not to a creator but to a single primordial cause which unfolds itself as the universe in all its diversity. As in the case of the previous conception, this causal principle or the creative ground also is conceived of in diverse ways. Thus, it appears as the infinite Aditi in one place and as time, Kala, in another. In a remarkably profound hymn, which marks the climax of speculative thought in the Rig Veda, it is designated as That One, That Ekam, a designation which, discarding all the earlier anthropomorphic mythology, unmistakably foreshadows the nameless power of the Upanishads, of which we shall soon have to speak. In the beginning, says the hymn says, there was neither being nor non-being, that one breathed calmly self-sustained, but it had within it, it adds, the latent power, tapas, out of which the whole universe, including the gods, developed afterwards. The point to be specially noted here is the conception of the ultimate entity as dynamic or self-evolving and as therefore requiring no outside power to guide and shape it. This current thought, as already stated, is often found blended with the other one of monotheism. The reason for it is that the Supreme God, as conceived in the period, is not always identified with the other gods alone, but also with the whole universe of which he is the creator. He is all and everything, is what, for example, is said in one place of the Prajapati. That is, the Supreme God is regarded not merely as a creator, externally related to the world, but also as constituting its very substance, as the monistic principle does. It is now usual to represent the monism of the later mantras and the brahmanas as pantheistic, but it is not correct to do so, since the term as applicable to this teaching connotes to the idea not merely of immanence but also transcendence. Thus, for instance, what is known as the hymn of man declares, having covered the world on all sides, it extended beyond it the length of 10 fingers. The primal principle, no doubt, is immanent in the world which emerges from it, but is certainly not exhausted by it. Ritualism. The purpose of invoking the several gods of nature was at first mostly to gain their favor for success in life here as well as hereafter. The prayers were then naturally accompanied by simple gifts like grain and ghee, but this simple form of worship became more and more complicated and gave rise in course of time to elaborate sacrifice, as also to a special class of professional priests who alone, it was believed, could officiate at them. There are illusions in the later hymns of rites which lasted for very long periods and at which several priests were employed by the sacrificer. The brahmanas, in which the elaborate ritualism is taught, altogether subordinate the earlier mantras to it. They do indeed utilize them, but often sundering them from their original context and sometimes even severing them from their original significance. More noteworthy than this elaboration was the change that came over the spirit with which offerings were made to the gods in this period. What prompted the performance of sacrifices was no longer the thought of prevailing upon the gods to bestow some favor or to ward off some danger. It was rather to compel or coerce them to do what the sacrificer wanted to be done. This change of spirit is explained by many among modern scholars as the importing of the magical element into Vedic religion, and is taken by them as a sign of the transfer of power from the gods to the priests. There is no doubt that belief in magic was widely current in the period, as is shown by the Atharva Veda, which is largely a book of sorcery and witchcraft. But, as indicated by the general tone of the rest of the Vedic literature, it seems to have been confined to the lower strata of society. The altered spirit behind the offer of sacrifices more probably only means faith in the efficacy of Vedic prayers as such and not in the potency of priests. That would correspond with the unqualified reverence which, as we shall see later, came to be shown to the whole text of the Veda by the adherents of the various orthodox doctrines. The power of conferring good thus seems them to have been transferred from gods not to the priests but directly to the Veda itself. But whatever name we may give it and however we may understand its implications, It is certain that there was a profound change in the conception of sacrifice and consequently in that of the relation between gods and men. All that came to be insisted upon was a scrupulous carrying out of every detail connected with the various rites, and the good result accruing from them, whether here or elsewhere, was believed to follow automatically from it. It is this sacrificial correctness that constitutes the third meaning of vrita, to which we alluded above. Ritualistic punctilio thus comes to be placed on the same level as natural law and moral rectitude. To judge from extant works, ritualism in this extreme form appears to be the predominant teaching of the later Vedic period. But as the other two tendencies of monotheism and monism also undoubtedly prevailed then, the prominent place it occupies in those works is in all probability the result of the bias in that direction of the scholar priests who were responsible for the compilation of the Veda as it has come down to us. Three. To take up now the consideration of the Upanishads. The word Upanishad literally means secret teaching, rahasya, or the teaching which was jealously guarded from the unworthy and was imparted in private only to the pupils of tried character. It has since come to be applied also to the treatises which embody such teaching. The number of these treatises as commonly reckoned is very large, but only about a dozen of them can be classed as genuine parts of Vedic literature. The rest, which belong to a later period, are relatively of inferior value. The classical Upanishads, as the former may be described, represent the flower of Vedic thought. They are written in rhythmic prose, where they are not metrical, and they possess, on the whole, a musical quality all their own. The reader, even when not familiar with their teaching, easily grasps their general import, and their power of transporting one out of oneself is remarkable. Broadly speaking, the teaching of the Upanishads marks a reaction against that of the Brahmanas, which, as already pointed out, inculcate an elaborate system of ritual. In more than one place, they decree the value of sacrifice. To cite only a single instance, one Upanishad declares that it is not pleasing to the God that man should know the ultimate truth, for that, by revealing to him their true place in the universe, which is by no means supreme, will result in their losing the sacrificial offerings they would otherwise receive from him. The gods, according to this view, are much like men, and their worship or sacrifices to them brings no lasting results, as devotion to philosophic truth does. But it has to be added that within the Vedic period itself, this spirit of antagonism to ritual is modified and ceremonial life comes to be recognized as necessary, either directly or indirectly, for attaining the true and final goal of life. The Upanishads thus came finally to represent the teaching of the Veda in its entirety, and not of its final portions only. Here we see illustrated a characteristic feature of all advance in Indian culture, namely, that when a new stage of progress is reached, the old is not discarded but is sooner or later incorporated in it. There are great, almost insurmountable difficulties in deciding what exactly is the teaching of the Upanishads in certain important respects. This accounts for the emergence in later times of diverse schools of Vedanta, all of which claim to propound the Upanishadic teaching. It is clear, however, that the prevailing view in them is monistic and absolutistic. That is to say, they teach that the ultimate reality is one and only one. It's unseen but pervasive. Presence is thus set forth in one of the Upanishads. It is Brahman that is below and is above, that is to the west and that to the east, that is to the south and to the north. Brahman indeed is this whole universe. The teaching is also idealistic in the sense that this single entity, reality, is conceived of as spiritual in its nature and that everything else is explained as existing in and through it. Referring to all things and to all living beings, another Upanishad says, all this is based upon spirit. Spirit is the foundation of the universe. Spirit is Brahman. This is not to say that either pluralism or the belief that the ultimate entities are many and realism or the belief that matter is as real as spirit or mind are unknown to the Upanishads taken as a whole. It only means that, as already indicated, they are not conspicuous in them. They appear that, like distant echoes of the teaching of the earlier portions of the Veda, which, speaking in the main, is neither monistic nor idealistic. Such a bifurcation of the Vedas is no doubt against Indian tradition, which has all along insisted on the unity of the Vedic teaching. Its contention is that because all portions of the Veda are alike revealed, there can be no disharmony in their teaching. But looking at the whole extent of Vedic literature and the vast stretch of time that separates the earliest from the latest portions of it, it would indeed be extraordinary if it did impart precisely the same teaching throughout. What is the exact character of the doctrine of unity which is predominant teaching of the Upanishads? It is necessary to call attention to certain details of the earlier Vedic teaching before attempting to answer this question. We have already indicated the presence of a monistic view in the later hymns. From the example cited in that connection and the name given in it to the unitary source, namely that one, it will be seen that the monism is the result of trying to account for the whole universe, nature, men and gods, regarded from the outside or objectively. There are other conceptions of the same kind in the older literature, and one of them which gradually grows in importance is Brahman. To the question raised in the Rig Veda, what was the wood and what the tree from which they fashioned forth the earth and heaven? The following answer is given later on in a Brahmana. Brahman was the wood, Brahman was the tree out of which they carved heaven and earth. This conception is very prominent in the Upanishads. The origin of the term is not quite clear, and it will suffice to refer here to one and several explanations now given of it. The word Brahman, the reader will recall, signifies prayer, being derived from a root bra, means to grow or expand. It is also stands for the power of which of itself burst into utterance as prayer. And it is to this meaning that according to some among present-day scholars, we should trace the philosophical significance of the term, namely, the power or primary principle which spontaneously manifests itself as the universe. There is a second current of thought in the earlier literature which also we should take into account if we are to understand clearly the monistic doctrine of the Upanishads. Its aim is the discovery not of a cosmic principle, the source of the world as a whole, but of the psychic principle, the inner essence of man. Its origin should be ascribed to the belief that the proper study of mankind is man. Man's conception of himself, however, is notoriously vague, and anything from the gross body to the subtlest principle underlying individual existence may be signified by it. We have almost all the possible alternatives represented in Vedic literature, such as the breath or life, prana, and the senses, indriya. The culmination of this inquiry is represented by Atman, or the self, which is sometimes described negatively by denying that it is breath, the senses, etc., which are all the not-self, anatman, and sometimes as the true subject which knows but can never be known, the unseen seer, the unheard hearer, and the unthought thinker. The idea in either case is that it is unknowable in the ordinary sense of the time, of the term. One Upanishad brings out this uniqueness of the self by stating paradoxically that it is known only to those that do not know it, meaning that though intuitively realizable, it cannot be made the object of thought. Thus, Brahman means the eternal principle as realized in the world as a whole, and Atman the inmost essence of one's own self. These two conceptions, Brahman and Atman, are of great importance and occur not only independently in the literature of this period, but are sometimes correlated with each other, and their parallelism is pointed out by representing the self of the world as related to the physical universe in the same manner in which the individual self is related to its body. Thus, in the Atharva Veda, the universal self or world soul is stated to have the earth for its feet, the atmospheric region for its belly, the sky for its head, the sun and moon for its eyes, and the wind for its breath. The two conceptions are also sometimes identified, and it is this happy identification of them that constitutes the essential teaching of the Upanishads. It is represented by the well-known saying, Tat Thou Art, Tatvam Asi, and I am Brahman, Aham Brahmasmi. They mean that the principle underlying the world as a whole and that which forms the essence of man are ultimately the same. Here ended the long Indian quest for the pervasive cause of all things, the search, as the Upanishads express it, for that by knowing which all will be known. Passages descriptive of Brahman alone or of Atman alone occur frequently in the Upanishads, but they are not peculiar to them, being also found in the earlier literature. Their explicit identification, on the other hand, is specifically Upanishadic. It is necessary to point out the full significance of this identification. Brahman as the ultimate cosmic principle or the source of the whole universe is all comprehensive. But such a principle need not be spiritual in its nature and may well be a material or physical entity. Further, an objective conception like the above is little more than a hypothesis to account for the origin of the universe, and there is nothing compelling us to regard it as actually existing, there being no logical absurdity in denying it. Some thinkers already seem to have done so in the Upanishadic period and maintain that in the beginning this world was just non-being. The establishment of the spiritual character of this principle and the removal of this uncertainty about its existence are both accomplished by its identification with Atman or the Self. For our own Self is known to us to be spiritual, and there is an intuitive obligation to recognize it, in some sense, as indubitable. If we start from the idea of a Self instead of that of Brahman, we meet with a similar difficulty, for while the Self points to what is spiritual and is an incontrovertible certainty, it is, as known to us, necessarily limited in its nature. Whatever we view, we make take of its nature, it is determined on one side by the world of nature and on the other hand by the other selves. It is this deficiency of finiteness that is made good by its identification with Brahman or the all-comprehensive first cause of the universe. The outcome of the identification, therefore, is that the ultimate reality, which may indifferently be termed either Brahman or Atman, is spiritual, and that it accounts for not only all the selves but also the whole of the physical universe. That is the meaning of monism or the doctrine of unity as taught in the Upanishads. The spiritual and unitary character of this absolute reality is very well expressed by the classical phrase Sachidananda. As a single term defining its nature, it is met with only in the later Upanishads, but its three elements, Sat, Chit and Ananda, are used of Brahman singly and in pairs even in the earliest of them. Sat, which means being, points to the positive character of Brahman, distinguishing it from all the non-being. But positive entities, to judge from our experience, may be spiritual or not. The next epithet, Chit, which means sentience, shows that it is spiritual. The last epithet, Ananda, which stands for peace, indicates its unitary and all-embracing character, inasmuch as variety is the source of all trouble and restlessness. Fear arises from the other, as the famous Upanishad saying has it. Thus, the three epithets together signify that Brahman is the sole spiritual reality or the absolute, which comprehends not only all being, Sat, but also thought, Chit, so that whatever partakes of the character of either must eventually be traced to it. In other words, it is the source of the whole universe, while it itself is self-existent and self-revealing, there being no other entity from which it could be derived or by which it might be made known. Another of the chief difficulties is the understanding the Upanishads arises in determining the exact relation of this unitary principle to the world and to the individual selves. There are several passages which teach that the world is but an appearance and that it has no actual place in the ultimate reality. There are other passages, not less numerous, which grant reality to the world, though at the same time they maintain that it is never apart from Brahman or the absolute Shankara. Shankara examines both these positions in his several commentaries and concludes that the former is the true teaching of the Upanishads. The latter view, according to him, is put forward in them only tentatively, that is, it marks only the first step in the teaching, and that the Upanishads finally retract this view, affirming in its place the other, namely that Brahman and nothing besides it is truly real. Thus, reality conceded to the world in such passages is not meant to be taken as ultimate. The concession is merely for adjusting the final teaching to common or empirical ways of thinking, which assume diversity to be quite real. It represents but the lower truth, Aparavidya, which serves as a stepping stone to comprehension of the higher, Paravidya. A distinction which is sometimes explicitly endorsed in the Upanishads. As regards the individual self, Shankara takes it to be Brahman itself appearing as finite because of its adjuncts like the body, which as parts of the physical universe are not real in the true sense of the term. There have, however, been other eminent exponents of the Upanishadic doctrine, some of them like Bhatra Parpancha, being anterior to Samkara, who maintained that the self and the physical universe, though they may be finite and imperfect, are real, but that they are not altogether different from Brahman. That is to say, they are both identical with and different from it, the three together constituting a unity in diversity. As Brahman, the ultimate reality is one, but as souls and the world, it is many. The whole universe on this view actually emerges from Brahman and therefore necessarily partakes of its character of reality. The richness of its content indicates that Brahman, its source, is complex. Only the complexity is sometimes manifest and other times latent. The former is the period of creation, Srishti, and the latter is the dissolution, Pralaya, which according to immemorial Indian belief succeed each other endlessly. At the end of each cycle, the variety returns to Brahman, but re-emerges from it at the beginning of the next cycle. The distinction made here between a latent and manifest stage of the universe implies the dynamic character of ultimate reality, and that the view is accordingly described as the doctrine of self-evolving Brahman, Brahma Parinama Vada. This view, also like the previous one, is monistic, since it admits no reality outside Brahman. It may also be described as idealistic, for though it may not explain the world as an appearance, it denies ultimate meaning or value to it, except when viewed as an element in Brahman, the absolute spirit. In whichever of these two ways we conceive of Brahman, it is the source from which the universe, in all its organic and inorganic aspects, comes into being. In the first place, it gives rise to the five elements. Bhuta, as they are called, space, akasha, air, vayu, fire, agni, water, up, and earth, prithvi. Each of these elements has its own distinctive quality. Space is characterized by sound, sabda, air by touch, sparsha, fire by color, rupa, water by taste, rasa, and earth by odor, gandha. This classification, which has been accepted by nearly all the later Indian philosophers, it is obvious, corresponds to the fivefold scheme of the organs of sense, those of hearing, touch, sight, taste, and smell, and should have been suggested by it. From these elements are derived, on the one hand, the whole of the inorganic world consisting of things like hills and rivers, and on the other, the organic bodies of plants, animals, and men, all of which house souls which are ultimately Brahman itself, or in any case, not quite different from it. What is the bearing of such a view of ultimate reality on our everyday life? The most striking feature of the latter is the conviction which it involves, namely, that diversity is real and ultimate. The presupposition of most, if not all, of the activities of life is that one man is different from another. The very efforts made through social and political organizations to unify men implied that they regard themselves as distinct. If man is distinct from man, his distinction from his physical environment is even clearer. It is not merely that he is distinct from matter. Matter itself, whether it serves as an adjunct of the self, like the physical body and the organs of sense, or as its environment, seems to be diverse in its character, each object having its own individuality, or as the Upanishads express it, its own name, nama, and its own form, rupa. It is obvious that if monism is the truth, no part of this diversity can be ultimate. That is the significance of the teaching of the Upanishads, so far as our common beliefs are concerned. The diversity given in everyday experience may only be an appearance of Brahman, and therefore false, as one school of interpreters of the Upanishads holds. But even according to the other school, it is not the whole of truth, for unity also is equally real. And yet, it appears to be the sole truth, owing to an inveterate habit of our mind which should be traced to our ignorance, avidya, of the ultimate reality. This is what is meant by Maya, the power or the principle that conceals from us the true character of reality. The ignorance may be regarded as negative, that is, as merely a lack of knowledge of the unity underlying the diversity given in common experience, or it may be looked upon as positive in the sense that it gives rise to a misapprehension making us see the manifold world where there is Brahman and only Brahman. In the former case, our knowledge would be correct so far as it went, although it did not go far enough to comprehend the unity also. In the latter case, it would be almost completely erroneous. Goal of life, as conceived in the Upanishads is in either case to overcome this congenital ignorance by attaining full enlightenment or jnana. The enlightened state is called release or moksha. It is attaining one's true selfhood in Brahman. This enlightenment, however, does not mean only an intellectual apprehension of the view that all is one, but also an actual realization of that unity in our own experience. In other words, the aim of studying philosophy is not merely to gratify theoretical curiosity, however disinterested that curiosity may be. It is also to live the right kind of life, consciously adjusting one's conduct to one's intellectual convictions. It is in this sense of devotion to worthier living and not in the sense of dogma or superstition that religion is blended with philosophy in India. Acquiring such enlightenment means a long course of training. In the first place, the truth as taught in the Upanishads needs to be learned from a proper preceptor, guru. This stage of the learning is called sravana or formal study. But merely to accept the teaching, although it may be quite true, would constitute blind faith. And it does not become philosophy until its rational support is sought out. The beliefs of others are no doubt often of immense use to us, for we cannot know everything for ourselves. Man's advance is mostly due to capacity for receiving and profiting by the thought and experience of others. But the matter is altogether different in the case of a subject like philosophy, whose relation to life is so peculiarly intimate. Others may teach us here the truths which they have reached as well as the method by which they did so, but unless we successfully repeat that process and rediscover those truths for ourselves, we cannot get the depth of conviction which alone can be called philosophy in the complete sense of the term. If there are facts which are beyond the reach of reason and cannot therefore be absolutely demonstrated, philosophy should at least point to the likelihood of their being true. This is recognized in the Upanishads, for they prescribe that what is called manana or reflection, in addition to study, sravana, in the sense of learning the truth from a preceptor. It means that philosophy, though it may begin as faith, does not end there. The training prescribed in the Upanishads does not stop here. It includes also what is called dhyana or meditation, which means constant dwelling upon the truth of which one has become intellectually convinced. This meditation is otherwise known as yoga, of which more will be said in the sequel. A number of sections in the Upanishads are taken up with describing modes of exercise or upasanas, as they are called, which prepare the disciple for contemplating the ultimate truth by accustoming him to draw away his mind from all disturbing thoughts and fix it on one object only. The aim of the final contemplation is to enable him to grasp the unity of existence directly as he grasps its diversity. Thus, if reflection, manana, is for getting intellectual conviction, meditation, dhyana is for gaining direct experience. Without the acquisition of such immediate or intuitive experience, philosophy, even if it represents a logical certainty, will be of purely academic interest. Such theoretical knowledge may be a mental accomplishment, but being mediate, it cannot dispel the immediate conviction in the ultimacy of diversity and will not therefore become a permanent influence on life. The Upanishads base this part of the teaching on a fact of experience, namely that a mediate knowledge of truth cannot overcome an immediate illusion, that seeing alone is believing. But to be effective or even possible, the meditation requires not merely an intellectual conviction concerning the ultimate truth, but also detachment from selfish interests. This was the idea underlying the practice referred to earlier of keeping the Upanishadic teaching as a secret and imparting it only to true and tried pupils. Give it to none that is not tranquil, says one Upanishad, for it was feared that an indiscriminate broadcasting of the truth that all is one might lead to its distortion and bring it into discredit. The ethical training with detachment signifies is generally taken for granted in the Upanishads and is consequently not dwelt upon much in them. But where they refer to it, they definitely bring out its importance, as for example, in the beginning of the Kadha Upanishad, where a youth seeks to know from the god of death whether the soul survives the body or not, is tempted in several ways by the offer of wealth and power before the truth is made known to him. But it is not merely a spirit of self-abnegation that is presupposed by Upanishadic teaching. Equal emphasis is laid in it on what is described as social morality. Thus, in another Upanishad, Prajapati, who is known as ethical authority, as we know, enjoins the practice not only of self-denial but also of generosity and compassion. The Upanishads describe Brahman itself as without evil, a description whose implication is that he who desires to attain Brahmahood should strive to free himself from all forms of evil. As Max Muller says, goodness and virtue are a sine qua non for the attainment of the highest knowledge, which brings the soul back to its source and to its home and restores it to its true nature. The culmination of this ethical training is symbolized in formal renunciation or sannyasa, which finds a prominent place in the Upanishads. It is the ascetic vritti has distinguished from the activist pravritti way of life taught in the Brahmanas, a distinction to which we shall refer at some length in the next chapter. To restate briefly the entire course of discipline, the necessary preconditioning for starting on the course of Vedantic life is detachment. In other words, no one that has not undergone a course of ethical training calculated to kill all egoistic impulses is qualified for a serious study of the Upanishads. When this preliminary qualification is acquired, there is a threefold training which is mainly intellectual, learning the ultimate truth with the assistance of a teacher, Sravana, reflection of that upon that has been learned so learned with a view to convince oneself of the certainty or at least the probability of it, Manana, and meditation, which aims at deepening and intensifying the conviction until it effectively uproots all beliefs that are inconsistent with it, Dhyana. The goal of life, as already indicated, is the attainment of release, moksha, from the empirical state of samsara or the recurrent round of birth and death. It is becoming Brahman, or what comes to the same thing, the realization of one's own true nature. In accordance with the double view of the ultimate reality found in the Upanishads, this is conceived in two ways. It is a condition, according to some like Sankara, in which the self remains by itself, partless and peaceful. And according to the others like Bhartra Prapancha, it is a condition in which only the sense of diversity as ultimate disappears and all the all-comprehensive reality is experienced as identical with oneself. In either case, it is a state of moral and intellectual perfection, transcending the distinction we commonly make between the self and the not-self, and between good and evil. That this goal is achievable in the present life seems to be the teaching of an Upanishads taken as a whole. It is known as Jivan Mukti, or liberation while still alive. When all desires lodged in the heart disappear, says the Khada Upanishads, then man becomes immortal and even here attains Brahman. Here, for instance, is a distinct mention of it. In the condition of Jivan Mukti, the diversity of the world, even according to those who believe it to be false, does not cease to appear, but the belief in its ultimacy is once for all destroyed. This conception of release marks a great advance on the earlier Vedic belief that the final ideal of man can be attained only hereafter. Socrates is stated to have brought philosophy down from human to heaven to earth. The seers of the Upanishads, we may say, discovered that heaven itself is on the earth, could one but realize it. When in the end a person that has reached this stage is dissociated from these physical accompaniments, he becomes Brahman itself. That is final release, Vaideha Mukti. We have so far restricted our attention to persons who succeed in killing every passion and acquire complete enlightenment in this life. But their number must necessarily be very small. Of the others who form the large majority, the Upanishads may be said to make two broad divisions. Those that pursue the right path of life, though they are not able to acquire full enlightenment in this life, and those that yield to natural impulses because they lack self-control. The former, the second best, progress from one state of existence to a higher without returning to the world of mortals, until at last they find release from the cycle of births and deaths. This progressive realization, Krama Mukti, of the ideal of life is what some Vedantins consider to be the sole form of release taught in the Upanishads. It corresponds to the eschatological view of the goal of man, as it was understood in the earlier stages of the Vedic period. Only the result is conceived here as absolute liberation from the conditions of worldly existence and not as a sublimated life of joy in the world of gods. The latter class of people, on the other hand, namely the self-indulgent who fail to bridle their desires, are born again and again, their condition in any particular life being determined the nature of their deeds and the nature of their thoughts in the past. In the belief in the karma doctrine implied here, forms a characteristic feature of Upanishadic teaching, but it will be convenient to defer its consideration to the next chapter. It is enough for the present to refer to the clear enunciation in the Upanishads of the moral law underlying the belief, namely, that good deeds lead to good and evil deeds to evil. There is one other point to which a brief reference is necessary before we close this section, namely, the place of theism in the Upanishads. We have already sketched its growth to the close of Brahmana period. In tracing the subsequent history of it in the next chapter, we shall mention the place which monotheism, strictly so termed, finds in the Upanishads. But there is also another form of it in them, about which a few words should be now added. It has not been developed in the like the conception of Prajapati, for instance, from the polytheism of the mantras. It is directly derived from the Brahman Atman conception and in consonance with it. The Supreme God is here taken to be immanent in all that constitutes the universe, including gods and men. This fact is indicated by the name generally given to it in the Upanishads, namely Isa or Ishvara, Lord, who lives as the inner guide, Antaryamin, in all objects in the universe. Ishvara in this sense is only the personified form of Brahman. The term does not accordingly signify a creator other than the created, as God is conceived in monotheism, but a principle which is eventually one with it. To express the same in the terminology of later Vedanta, God as conceived here is the material as well as the efficient as may be expected. Often, as well as the efficient cause of the universe. This personified conception of Brahman, as may be expected, often passes insensibly into that of the Absolute in the teaching of the Upanishads.